This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Charles Lindsay McNary, June 12, 1874. Contents 1. Early life 11. Legal career 2. State politics 3. Federal politics 31. Senate years 32. Vice presidential nomination 4. Family and legacy 5. References 6. External links. Early life. McNary was born on his maternal grandfather's family farm north of Salem on June 12, 1874. He was the 9th of 10 children, and the 3rd son, born to Hugh Lindsay McNary and Mary Margaret McNary née Claggett when the two married in 1860. Hugh McNary's father-in-law gave him a 112-acre 045. Returning to farming near Salem when McNary's mother died in 1878, his father moved the family to Salem where he bought a general merchandise store after being unable to run the family farm because of declining health. Charles, known as Tot, began his education at a one-room school in Kaiser and later attended Central School in Salem, living on North Commercial Street. Hugh McNary died in 1883, making Charlie an orphan at the age of 9. Nina McNary became the head of the household, while other siblings took jobs in order to provide for the family. As a boy, Charles worked as a paperboy, in an orchard, and at other farming tasks. He met Herbert Hoover, a future U.S. president, who moved to Salem in 1888. He later worked in the county recorder's office for his brother John Hugh McNary, who had been elected as county recorder in 1890, and for a short time attended the Capital Business College. After leaving that school, he enrolled in college preparatory classes at Willamette University, with an eye towards attending Stanford University or the University of California. During this time he met Jesse Brayman, whom he began dating, at a social club he helped start. Another member of the club was Oswald West, a future governor of Oregon. Legal career in the autumn of 1896, McNary moved to California to attend Stanford, where he studied law, economics, science, and history while working as a waiter to pay for his housing. He left Stanford and returned to Oregon in 1897 after his family asked him to come home back in Salem. He read law under the supervision of his brother John and Samuel L. Hayden, and passed the bar in 1898. The brothers practiced law together in Salem as McNary Newberg. On her way home to Salem, she had been in Oregon to attend the funeral of her mother and was returning from Portland in the Boise family's car when it flipped and crushed her. McNary spent several days in Oregon for her funeral and then returned to Washington. Charles and Jesse had no children. State politics. Senator McNary and Representative Gilbert N. Haugen, co-sponsors of the McNary-Haugen Farm Relief Bill, shake hands at the White House in 1929. McNary first held public office in 1892 when he became Marion County's deputy recorder, remaining in the position until 1896. In 1904 he managed successful campaign of his brother, John, for district attorney for the 3rd Judicial District of Oregon. John then appointed Charles as his deputy, who served until 1911. Steve Neal, McNary's biographer, describes McNary as a progressive who stuck with the Republican Party in 1910 even when many progressives left the party in favor of West, a Democrat. McNary backed the progressive-era reforms. The initiative, recall, referendum, primary elections, and the direct election of U.S. Senators of Oregonian William Simon Urin, and he was an early supporter of public, rather than private, power companies. After West won the election, he chose McNary to be special legal counsel to Oregon's Railroad Commission, who urged lower passenger and freight rates. Meanwhile, McNary maintained friendly relations with both progressive and conservative factions of the Oregon Republicans and with West. In 1913, West appointed McNary to the Oregon Supreme Court to fill a new position, created by the legislature's expansion of the court from 5 justices to 7. The youngest of the justices, at 38, McNary left law school and private practice behind. He quickly established himself as a judicial activist and strong advocate of progressive reform. A supporter of organized labor, McNary consistently defended the rights of injured workers and was not hesitant about using the bench as an instrument for social change, such as an 8-hour day for public employees. Unions supported McNary throughout his political career. Several criminal convictions resulted from the Portland Vice scandal in November 1912 surrounding the city's gay male subculture. By the time McNary was seated, some convictions had been appealed to the court. He wrote the dissenting opinion in the reversal of the conviction of prominent Portland attorney Edward McAllister. The dissent was emotionally charged and revealed a deeply seated personal discomfort with same-sex eroticism. In 1914, the court moved into the new Oregon Supreme Court building, and McNary filed to run for a full six-year term on the bench. At that time the office was partisan, and McNary lost the Republican primary, by a single vote, to Henry L. Benson. After several recounts and the discovery of uncounted ballots after his defeat, he served the remainder of his partial term and left the court in 1915 on July 8, 1916, after a close, multi-blow contest, with several contenders. The Republican State Committee elected McNary to be the chair. He was seen as someone who could unify the progressive and conservative wings of the party in Oregon federal politics as chairman of the state's Republican Party. McNary campaigned to get the Republican presidential nominee, Charles Evans Hughes, elected in the 1916 presidential election. Hughes, a former U.S. Supreme Court justice and future chief justice, carried Oregon but lost the presidency to the incumbent, Woodrow Wilson. When U.S. Senator Harry Lane died in office, on May 23, 1917, it created an opportunity for McNary to redeem himself after his failed bid for election to the Oregon Supreme Court. McNary was among several possible successors considered by Oregon Governor James Withycombe. The governor preferred someone who supported national women's suffrage and prohibition, and he shared with McNary an interest in farming. Furthermore, McNary supporters argued that both progressive and conservative factions of the Republican Party would accept McNary and that unity would give the party the best chance of retaining the Senate seat in the next election. Withycombe appointed McNary to the unexpired term on May 29. McNary Dam on the Columbia River. After resigning as state party chairman, McNary prepared to campaign for a full term in the Senate. He faced Speaker of the Oregon House of Representatives Robert N. Stanfield in the May 1918 Republican primary. McNary defeated Stanfield 52,546 to 30,999 in the November general election. He defeated a friend and former governor, Oswald West, 82,360 to 64,303, to win a full, six-year term in the Senate. Meanwhile, Frederick W. Mulkey won the election to replace McNary and finished Lane's original term, which would end in January 1919, and Mulkey took office on November 6, 1918, replacing McNary in that seat. Shortly after taking office, Mulkey resigned the seat effective December 17, 1918, and McNary was then reappointed to the Senate on December 12, 1918, and took office on December 18, instead of taking office in January, when his term he was elected to would have started. Mulkey resigned in order to give McNary a slight seniority edge over other new members of the Senate in 1920. Former adversary Stanfield defeated incumbent Democrat George Earl Chamberlain for Oregon's other Senate seat, making McNary the state's senior senator. McNary won re-election four times, in 1924, 1930, 1936, and 1942, serving in Washington, D.C., until his death. Senate years after World War I, Wilson sought Senate approval of the Treaty of Versailles because the treaty included provisions for establishing and joining the League of Nations, one of Wilson's 14 points. Republicans opposed it, going against much of his party. McNary, part of a group of senators known as reservationists, proposed minor changes to support the United States' entry into the League. Ultimately, the Senate never ratified the Treaty of Versailles, and the United States never joined the League. One of the prime opponents of Wilson and the League was Senate Majority Leader Henry Cabot Lodge. After McNary demonstrated his skill in the debate over the League, Lodge took him under his wing, and the two formed a longtime friendship. The friendship helped McNary secure favorable committee assignments and ushered him into the inner power circle of the Senate. Early in his career, he served as chairman of the Irrigation and Reclamation of Arid Lands Committee, and as a member of the Agriculture and Forestry Committee. In 1922, President Warren G. Harding asked McNary to be the Secretary of the Interior to replace Albert B. Fall because of Fall's involvement in the ongoing Teapot Dome scandal. McNary declined, preferring to stay in the Senate. McNary as senator. In 1933, McNary was selected as the Senate Minority Leader by fellow Republicans. While the Senate was under Democratic control during the New Deal era, he remained minority leader for the rest of his time in office and hovered most of the time on the periphery of the Republican left and opposed disciplining Republican senators who supported Roosevelt. He supported many of the New Deal programs at the beginning of Roosevelt's presidency. As World War II approached, he favored all aid to England and France short of war. He voted to keep an arms embargo in place but supported the Lend-Lease Agreement with the British in 1941 and the reinstatement of selective service in 1940, in preparation for military conscription of civilian men as early as the 1920s. McNairy supported the development of federal hydroelectric power dams, and in 1933, he introduced legislation that led to the building of the Grand Coulee and Bonneville dams on the Columbia. As public works projects, he voted for the U.S. joining the World Court in 1926. He favored buying more national forest lands, reforestation, fire protection for forests via the Clark-McNairy Act, and farm support, although vetoed by President Calvin Coolidge. The McNairy-Haugen Farm Relief Bill was the forerunner of the farm legislation of the New Deal vice presidential nomination in 1940. He was the Republican nominee for vice president, as a Western farm leader chosen to balance the ticket of presidential nominee Wendell Willkie, a pro-business leader from the East. The two men differed on many issues, writing for Life magazine shortly before the general election in 1940. Richard L. Neuberger said, "Whether as vice president of the U.S. Charlie McNairy can keep on endorsing government power projects, isolation, high tariffs and huge outlays for farm relief under a president who believes in none of these things remains to be seen." McNairy's acceptance speech reiterated his support for the Tennessee Valley Authority, a federally owned power-producing corporation that Willkie, as the head of a far-flung utilities empire, had opposed during the campaign. McNairy promoted farming issues and criticized foreign trade agreements, which, he said, had closed European markets to our grain, meat, fruits and fiber. The Willkie-McNairy ticket lost decisively to the Roosevelt-Wallace ticket family and legacy on December 29, 1923. McNairy married for the second time, to Cornelia Woodburn Morton. He met Morton at a dinner party during World War I, in her hometown of Washington, D.C. Before the marriage, she had worked as his private secretary, as with his first marriage. His second did not produce children, but Charles and Cornelia adopted a daughter, Charlotte, in 1935, McNairy in 1912. In 1926, McNairy built a new $6,000 ranch-style house, which he designed himself, along two creeks on his farm north of Salem. His estate, called Fir Cone, featured a putting green, rose garden, tennis court, fishpond, an arboretum, and more than 250 acres ten. As it hosted many meetings with politicians from the national stage, the farm included 110 acres 045. Oregon State University are also named in his honor. References: Carrot ABCDEFGHI Neuberger, Richard L. The 12th of August 1940, McNairy of Fir Cone, Lifetime, Inc. pp. The 3rd of February 2007. Carrot Neil, McNairy of Oregon, p. 24. Carrot A. B. Neil, McNairy of Oregon, p. 30. Carrot A. B. C. Neil, McNairy of Oregon, pp. 29-38. Carrot Harry Lane, Biographical Directory of the United States Congress. United States Congress retrieved the 26th of November 2008. JSTOR. Oregon, pp. 85-88. Carrot ABC Terry, John. October 20, 2002. Oregon's Trails, Oregon's Sen. McNairy was a tree hugger for his time. The Oregonian p. Memorial services held in the House of Representatives and Senate of the United States, together with remarks presented in eulogy of Charles Lindsay McNairy, late a senator from Oregon's 78th Congress, second session. Historic images of Charles McNairy from Salem Public Library. Charlie Mack, Time Magazine, 6 March 1944, retrieved 10 August 2008. Harry Lane, U.S. Senator Class II from Oregon 1917-1918, served alongside George E. Chamberlain, succeeded James E. Watson. Senate Republican leader 1933-1944, succeeded. Born H. Lane. McNairy Mulkey. McNairy Corden R. Neuberger. Lusk M. Neuberger. Hatfield G. Smith. Merkley Class 3 J. Lane, Nesmith Corbett. Mitchell Slater. Mitchell Simon Fulton Chamberlain Stanfield Stiwer Reams Barry Hallman Morse Packwood Wyden V.E. United States Senate Minority Leaders Underwood Robinson McNairy Austin McNairy White Barkley Wary Bridges Johnson Noland Dirksen Scott Baker Bird Dole Dashley Lott Dashley Lott Dashley Reed McConnell Reed V.E. Republican Party Leaders in the United States Senate Lodge Curtis Watson McNairy Austin McNairy White Wary Bridges Taft Noland Dirksen Scott Baker Dole Lott Frist McConnell V.E. Chairman of the United States Senate Committee on Agriculture, Nutrition and Forestry. Agriculture 1829-1857, 1863-1881. Marks Seymour Brown Page P. Smith Mouton Lynn. Upham Sturgeon Soulé Allen abolished 1857-1863 Sherman Cameron Morton Frelinghuysen Paddock Johnston Agriculture and Forestry 1884-1977 Miller Palmer Paddock George Proctor. Hansbrow Dolliver Warren Burnham Gore Grana Norris McNary E. Smith Thomas Capper Thomas Ellender Aiken Ellender Talmadge Agriculture, Nutrition, and Forestry 1977. Talmadge Helms Leahy Lugar Harkin Lugar Harkin Cochran Chambliss Harkin Lincoln Stabenow Roberts v. E. United States Republican Party Chairpersons of the RNC. Morgan Raymond Ward Claflin Morgan Chandler Cameron Jewel Sabin Jones Key Clarkson Carter Hannah Payne Cortelyou New Hitchcock. Hill Rosewater Hills Wilcox Hayes Adams Butler Work Houston Fess Sanders Fletcher Hamilton Martin Walsh Spangler Brownell Reese. Scott Gabrielson Summerfield Roberts Hall Alcorn T. B. Morton Miller Birch Bliss R. Morton Dole Bush Smith Brock Richards Laxalt Fahrenkopf Reagan Fahrenkopf Atwater Uter Bond Barber Nicholson Gilmore Racicott Gillespie Melman Martinez Duncan Steele Priebus Presidential Tickets Fremont Dayton Lincoln Hamlin Lincoln Johnson Grant Colfax Grant, Wilson Hayes, Wheeler Garfield, Arthur Blaine, Logan Harrison, Morton Harrison, Reed McKinley, Hobart McKinley, Roosevelt Roosevelt, Fairbanks Taft, Sherman, Butler Hughes, Fairbanks Harding, Coolidge Coolidge, Dawes Hoover, Curtis Twice Landon, Knox Wilkie, McNary Dewey, Bricker. Dewey, Warren Eisenhower, Nixon Twice Nixon, Lodge Goldwater, Miller Nixon, Agnew Twice Ford, Dole Reagan, G.H.W. Bush Twice G.H.W. Bush, Quayle Twice Dole, Kemp G.W. Bush, Cheney Twice McCain, Palin Romney, Ryan Trump, Pence Parties by State and Territory State Alabama Alaska Arizona Arkansas California Colorado Connecticut Delaware Florida Georgia Hawaii Idaho Illinois Indiana Iowa Kansas Kentucky Louisiana Maine Maryland Massachusetts, Michigan, Minnesota, Mississippi, Missouri, Montana, Nebraska, Nevada, New Hampshire, New Jersey, New Mexico, New York, North Carolina, North Dakota, Ohio, Oklahoma, Oregon, Pennsylvania. Rhode Island, South Carolina, South Dakota, Tennessee, Texas, Utah, Vermont, Virginia, Washington, West Virginia, Wisconsin, Wyoming, Territory, American Samoa, District of Columbia, Guam, Northern Mariana Islands, Puerto Rico. Virgin Islands Conventions List 1856 Philadelphia 1860 Chicago 1864 Baltimore 1868 Chicago 1872 Philadelphia 1876 Cincinnati 1880 Chicago 1884 Chicago 1888 Chicago 1892 Minneapolis 1896 St. Louis 1900 Philadelphia 1904 Chicago 1908 Chicago 1912 Chicago